Welcome to Ask Swagelok. I'm your host, Craig Gifford, here today with Hassan El Ghoul, who is a fluid systems engineer for Swagelok, Ontario in Atlantic Canada. We've been talking, Hassan, about hydrogen production, specifically electrolyzers. In case someone's watching and a little bit new to the topic here, can you explain what an electrolyzer is?
Yeah, absolutely. An electrolyzer is a device that uses electrical current to split water into two types of molecules, oxygen and hydrogen.
Okay.
And this is what we're after.
Okay.
These molecules at the operating conditions that we operate at are at gaseous states. If we look at an electrolyzer, it has two compartments. Each compartment has an electrode, the cathode, which is negatively charged, and the anode, which is positively charged.
Okay.
And depending on the type of the electrolyzer, these two compartments are split using a different type of membrane. It could be a porous diaphragm. It could be a polymer membrane, depending on the type of the electrolyzer.
Okay.
There are so many types of electrolyzers out there. The most common ones are PEM, proton exchange membrane electrolyzers,
okay,
and alkaline electrolyzers.
So you mentioned there's multiple types of electrolyzers, specifically two main ones. Can you go into the differences between those two?
Yeah, absolutely. We'll start with the PEM, proton exchange membrane electrolyzer. This electrolyzer uses a polymer membrane, and that membrane allows the hydrogen ion, the proton, to pass from one electrode compartment to the other.
Okay.
Using electrical current. So the hydrogen is generated at the cathode side. Now, a few features about PEM. The first thing is that it takes high electrical current density. It has a high output pressure, which is really good because it gives us high pressure, so no need for a lot of compression after that.
Okay.
It uses noble metals in electrodes, like platinum, iridium, gold. It has a high electrochemical efficiency, which is really good.
Okay.
And it has high flexibility to load changes.
Okay.
That means it's compatible with sources that are fluctuating, like wind and solar.
Oh, great. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the other type of electrolyzer is alkaline.
Okay.
Now, this uses a liquid electrolyte solution, like sodium hydroxide, like potassium hydroxide. That's what we call lye.
Okay.
And the hydroxide ion travels through a porous diaphragm. So it's a diaphragm in this situation. Some features about alkaline electrolyzer, if we compare it to PEM, it takes low current density.
Okay.
So that affects the efficiency.
Yep.
It produces low output pressures.
Okay.
So that means you need to compress it from a lower pressure now. And the electrodes are made of low cost steel, and they're plated with nickel alloys.
Okay.
But it's obviously much cheaper than PEM. The last thing is flexibility to load changes. Unfortunately, it's not as flexible to load changes like PEM is.
Okay. So Hassan, as a new hydrogen production facility comes online, all of the fluid systems are subject to like a factory acceptance testing along the way. Even small leaks lead to inefficiencies and safety challenges. Can you walk us through some of those issues that arise with electrolyzers and the factors that can affect them?
When we think of electrolysis systems, and just like a lot of other hydrogen systems, we need to keep two big aspects in mind.
Okay.
Safety always comes first, and efficiency.
Okay.
Let's start with safety. When we think of electrolyzers, we are thinking of two critical gases.
Okay.
The first one is hydrogen, which is a flammable gas, which has a lower flammability limit of 4% in air. And the other gas is oxygen, which obviously leads to combustion.
Right.
So that's the safety part of it. The second aspect is efficiency. In case of a leakage, the gases are leaking into the atmosphere.
Right.
We need to remember that we've put so much energy into this electrolysis. Not only that, we're putting even more energy to compress it.
Yep.
So losing the gases to the atmosphere means you're losing energy.
Yeah, okay.
So really the bottom line is we need to think of the adequate sealing technology, not any sealing technology, a sealing technology that is made for small molecule gases.
That can contain everything.
Absolutely.
Yep. Okay. So the size of the plant directly affects the electrolyzer in terms of capacity and efficiency, even things like scalability and economics. What can be done about some of these common issues?
Let's start talking about the drivers that affect the efficiency in an electrolyzer.
Okay.
And then we can talk about scalability.
Okay.
So some of the factors that drive the efficiency in an electrolyzer is temperature. Usually higher temperatures lead to higher efficiencies in an electrolyzer. Another thing is electrode materials. That really drives the efficiency of this electrolysis process altogether.
Okay.
There's the current density. We already touched on that when we talked about different types of electrolyzers. But obviously, higher current densities lead to higher hydrogen production and efficiency as well. And lastly, electrolyte concentration. When we increase that concentration, we are driving this conductivity
okay.
and efficiency of an electrolyzer.
Okay.
Now, let's think of the challenges that come with electrolysis systems and scalability.
Okay.
First of all, we need to think of high capital costs.
Yep.
Electrolyzers are not cheap, especially some types of electrolyzers like PEM, where we're using noble metals, right? So that's a high capital cost that we're putting in there. The second thing is that when we think of electrolyzers, we're not only thinking of the electrolyzer unit only. It's a whole infrastructure,
okay.
right? So we need to think of compression. We need to think of refueling stations. We need to think of storage, virtual pipelines.
Yep.
It's a whole system working together.
Yep.
We already talked about efficiency. That's definitely a challenge. If we compare electrolysis to other modes of hydrogen production, like steam methane reforming, it has a lower efficiency.
Yep.
So that takes me to my next point, which is competition. It's a very competitive landscape. Because we are comparing this hydrogen production mode with other more established modes out there, like
yes.
steam methane reforming.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really hard for it to be competitive with a bigger scale.
So Hassan, tell us, what else should designers be considering when building around electrolyzers?
Designers should be looking at the subsystems surrounding the electrolyzer
yep.
and the whole fluid dynamics.
Okay.
So we can think of many things. We can think of line sizing. Do I really want to go bigger, mm-hmm. right? We hear a lot about erosional velocities. Is it really a concern? Because that leads to bigger sizes.
Yep.
And that really brings the efficiency down. The volume, the cost, the bulkiness, the footprint, a lot of things that are a result of going with bigger line sizes. We can think of heat recovery systems. We can think of valve sizing.
Okay.
We can think of subsystems that condition the hydrogen before taking it to compression.
Okay.
We can think of relief valves. Obviously, from the safety mm-hmm. perspective, we can think of the venting configurations. There are so many standards out there, like CGA 5.5.
Yep.
We can think of purging, and we can absolutely also think of quality.
Okay.
We need to evaluate the quality of this hydrogen. This hydrogen is going to end up maybe in a fuel cell, which is yep. very sensitive when it comes
to quality. Is that where grab sampling comes in?
Absolutely. So grab sampling is one means, or it could be an online analyzer
okay.
as well.
Well, Hassan, thanks for sharing your knowledge about electrolyzers. We really appreciate it. And thank you for joining us at Ask Swagelok.